My latest book is Race for Success, the 10 Best Business Opportunities for Blacks in America. And in that book, I sort of lay out a plan, manifesto, if you will, on what it is that we need to do to take our communities and lives to the next level as it relates to business. One of the things that we need to do is to add to the pantheon of black heroes in America, who typically are entertainers, athletes, and social activists. And God bless them. But we've got to add to the pantheon of black heroes business people, because these are the folk who are taking the risks, creating work and jobs, and contributing to production in America. Because that's what America is about. The business of America is business. And business is measured in production, not consumption. We're not a major factor when it comes to production. Of the $20 trillion of non-farm income produced by American businesses last year, black folks contributed less than 0.4%. That means if we fell off the face of the earth, it wouldn't matter in America. It would matter from a consumption standpoint, because we're the greatest consumers in America. Our $600 billion annual economy, the 11th richest economy in the entire world, goes one way, away from us. So production is what matters. What are we doing to engage in business to produce? As you heard me say, you cannot consume yourself into equality. You cannot consume yourself into power. So we have to become a communities of savers and owners, as opposed to a community of renters and consumers. I flush this out as sort of a philosophical base for my newest book, Race for Success, and then segue into, well, what are those business opportunities that can help us make a profit and make a difference, to do well while doing good? What are the categories of businesses that we ought to be looking at? How can we kill two birds with one stone, really make money and serve our community and serve our people? And the book covers those 10 categories, of which none I'm going to talk about now, because I want people gone by the book. Just kidding. I can outline it if you'd like. Those areas of opportunity include such categories as education. There's tremendous, tremendous opportunity in the area and business of education, which is one of the largest businesses in America, by the way. Where is that opportunity? Well, I live in Cleveland, Ohio. The budget to run the city of Cleveland is $350 million a year. The budget to run the schools of the city of Cleveland is $425 million a year. So the budget to run the schools is bigger than the budget to run the city. There's a lot of money there. What's happening with that money? What are they spending $400 million on a year? They're spending it on milk, pencils, paper, food for the kids, furniture, maintenance, carpentry. Much of these products are outsourced. Are we getting the benefit? Do we have businesses that are doing business with these urban education centers that are spending hundreds of millions of dollars miseducating many of our kids, not doing a very good job on education, but minimally, black businesses should be able to get some jobs out of the business of education. So, huge opportunities in the area of education, not only from providing the goods and services that are needed minimally in urban education, but also from a professional standpoint, we need more black teachers. You go into most urban schools, 85% of the teachers teaching the students don't look like the students. Now, there's nothing wrong with anybody who is good teaching our children. But all of a sudden, what we have seen and what we now know is that our children can't learn. But I tend to remember when we were in little classrooms in the South, could not go any place but these ill-equipped classrooms, and black teachers were teaching our children, somehow or another, we could learn. So, we need more black teachers. We need more black educators. And we need more black people involved in the business of education. Many of our conferences don't put a whole lot of emphasis on that, and much of it is inspiration and motivation. Now, that's very important for us. No question about that. But we've added even a new dimension to that when it comes to black conferencing in America. We are the first conference to commingle the secular, non-secular, the spiritual, and professional. That has always been dangerous territory because we have been taught and told by whites in America not to mix the two, business and spirituality. Well, maybe that's right for them, but that's not right for us. In fact, I deeply believe that if you're not reaching black people at a spiritual level, you're not reaching them. So that's another piece that as people come and view our conference, they're probably going to infuse and will see these kinds of things in other black conferences in America, and that's wonderful. So all we're really trying to do is make everything better by being the best.
Okay, is there anything else that you'd like to add?
No, I just am so glad to be sitting in front of this camera, sitting in front of you, and you allowing us to share with you our vision, and then take this message and these ideas to other people in other communities, and that's really what the conference has been about. You've seen all the television cameras around here. You know that we've taped everything for replay on the Word Network. That's another unique thing about the conference. It's the only conference in America, black or white, where there's 200 hours of post-conference television. Almost all of the major workshops, not workshops, but plenary sessions, will be replayed endlessly for a year on the Word Network, seen in 34 million homes. So we're real excited about that, meaning while there were nearly 3,000 registrants and 20,000 people here in Greater Cleveland from all over the world, 50 million people over the next year will see what we saw. And that's great.